Good afternoon to all our viewers and welcome to a new edition of The World Today. And of course, today we commit our episode to a special edition on the latest developments regarding the tragic Egypt Air flight incident that has recently struck. And of course, we will be discussing all the recent developments regarding this recent tragedy, offering, of course, all our condolences to the families of all the victims from every single member of this program's crew, as well as all the members of Nile TV International. Of course, a very tragic incident indeed. And joining us this afternoon for a further in-depth discussion into the latest developments is our guest, Dr. Samir Raghib, the political analyst. It's a very good afternoon to you, sir.
Welcome to you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Samir, for joining us. Let's start straight away with news from Al Ahram Online, and the headline reads, "More human remains, debris recovered in search for the Egypt Air plane." Egypt search teams have recovered more body parts and other debris from the site on the Mediterranean where the missing Egypt Air flight is assumed to have crashed on Thursday. Egypt Air said on its official Twitter account that the Egyptian flight, which the Egyptian Army and Navy had found body parts, luggage, passengers, personal belongings, as well as aeroplane seats. The military had said earlier on Friday that it had located personal belongings of the passengers and parts of the plane debris in the sea around 290 kilometers north of Alexandria. The Egyptian authorities, assisted by forces from France, Greece, Britain, Cyprus, and Italy, continue to scour the search area for further debris from the plane that disappeared from radar whilst flying over the Mediterranean on Thursday. All 66 people on board are presumed to have perished. The Airbus 320 jet, which was flying from Paris to Cairo, disappeared from radar screen shortly after entering Egyptian airspace early on Thursday morning. Later on Friday, the European Space Agency said that one of its satellites had detected a possible oil slick in the Mediterranean Sea in the same area where the Airbus vanished. The image taken by satellite shows a slick about 2 kilometers, roughly 40 kilometers southeast of the aircraft's last known location. Of course, the Egyptian state television has aired video footage of Egyptian air and naval forces during the search process, and Egyptian President Abdel Fattah al-Sisi has offered condolences to the families of the victims of this tragedy, declaring the country's official confirmation of the deaths. And of course, the head of the Coptic Orthodox Church, Pope Tawadros, said a mass service would be held for the deceased at Cairo's Abbasia Cathedral on Sunday. Now, Dr. Samir, a very tragic incident indeed, and the Russian jet crash and the Italian student case, and now the missing Egypt Air flight. How do you see a pattern? Lots of conspiracy theories have come out regarding this issue. Could you tell us a bit more about your thoughts on this recent tragedy?
First of all, I join your feeling about to send our condolences for the victims' families, neighbors, and friends. Also, our condolences for President Abdel Fattah al-Sisi. My manner of work or my paradigm not dependent on conspiracy theory, but we can't exclude it. But first, we must make analysis for the available data about the circumstances of the accident. Today, in addition to the news you mentioned today, the president of France, president, declared that there is a new evidence about a smoke on board from several places that come. It's for information via message that sent automatically via communication systems. Two minutes before the airliner disappeared from the radar, this message sent a new evidence that something wrong on board of the jet airliner. This not lead us for one possibilities. First of all, we have several possibilities that failure in the system, system failure, terror attack or illicit action, or off board targeting like air missile, anti-air missiles from non-state actors or from state actors. But we must eliminate this possibilities of off-board targeting from anti-air missile, anti-airplane missile, because this altitude is far from the last distances can reach this kind, the rocket or the missiles that non-state actors can acquire. So we have two possibilities. The first is terror attack. The second, the terror attack in the possibility of France side, not Egyptian side, because the airliner during the departure airport, the responsibility on the side of departure country and authority, aviation authority, and the security authority in France, in Charles de Gaulle airport. So the other side responsibility about malfunction that due to bad maintenance or bad working or something wrong from the crew of the airliner. So now we have three parts. Airbus is the company manufactured the airliner, France, the departure
location.
Location, and Egypt, the owner of the airliner, which is national airliner, Egypt Air. Some speak about that the pilot commits suicide, and this is ridiculous. And this,
and it's very far-fetched. There was a lot of evidence as well from the Greek authorities that the pilot, till the last minutes after he left the Greek airspace,
we speak about
was joking and
a high
and
professional pilot, a high moral pilot.
Well liked and respected among his peers. If you watched, of course,
the conspiracy in this point is that during the crisis of 990. Airliner, which downed 1999 in a trip between New York and Cairo. Then he alleged that Mr. Battuti committed suicide. Now I see each air accident, the first possible that
is the pilot's
yes, it's a pilot commits suicide,
which is ridiculous.
It's ridiculous. The terror attack, I think there are a very similar circumstances between Sharm el Sheikh airliner, Russian airliner dropped over Sinai, and this accident.
Dr. Samir, let me just, since you brought up the Russian airliner, I want to draw a comparison. During the Russian jet crash, Egypt was fully blamed for the situation. This time around, President Abdel Fattah el-Sisi and a lot of Egyptian authorities have pleaded and asked for people not to jump to conclusions, to wait till further evidence is brought forward, etc., not putting straight away the blame on the French airport or the French security
procedures
in the airport. Draw me the difference here in the response of the two nations and the two leaders both very big tragedies for both countries.
The similarity is between the accident, but we have to replace Russia side with Egyptian side and Egyptian side with French side. After the Sharm el Sheikh accident, the chief of Federal Investigation Bureau of Russia declared that this accident was committed by a terror attack.
Straight away?
Yes. In this moment, all the world
took up straight away.
Neglected the investigation, the authorized party, which is Egypt, and the Egyptian prosecutor general, then jumped to the conclusion. Yesterday, the same person declared that the same chief of investigation bureau of Russia declared that the Egyptian airliner, this time also, due to terror attack. Then all the world neglected this claim and committed to go forward that it's a negligence, it's a bad maintenance.
So now let's go to the real question. Why is this so?
This
is it a perception, double standards?
The double standard, which is not in the airliner accident, which is in economy, in politics, in human rights.
So if it has to do with Europe and the Western world,
yes,
they are not to blame.
It's for the state actors, it's this act is intentional, but for the publicity, it's a matter of perception.
Indeed.
Yes, it's a matter not a conspiracy behind their perception, but their perception about it's a third world countries. It's hardly know to how to read and write. How they can manage
a whole era. Yet we've had one of the best safety tracks amongst all countries when it came to our trips and our aviation facilities.
Aviation, our airports.
Our pilots,
our
top
pilots,
of the range,
yes,
pilots.
This pilot own more than 6,000
hours of travel.
Hours of,
so he's very well,
yes,
very well knowledge. Let's go
also
to the independent.
Also the co-pilot, more than 2,000 hours.
Let's move to another item, another story from the Independent. Headline reads, Egypt Air Flight MS-804 crash. Smoke detectors in the toilet and window sensors were triggered.
Yes.
7 minutes before contact with was lost with Egypt Air Flight 804, a sequence of automatic messages were sent from the doomed aircraft that indicate multiple issues on board, possibly including fire in a lavatory and the main electronics bay. However, no distress calls were made from the Airbus before it crashed. All 66 people on board the flight are presumed to have died. The French accident investigators confirmed the content of the electronic messages transmitted to Egypt Air Engineering Base from the aircraft. They were revealed overnight by the Aviation Herald, which is regarded as a serious and credible site. It says it received details of messages sent by the aircraft communications addressing the reporting system, which is called ACARS, from three independent sources. 7 messages were received in the course of 3 minutes, starting from 2:26 a.m. Cairo local time. 3 concerned window sensors and 2 mentioned smoke in a laboratory at the avionics bay, which is underneath the flight deck. Now, if a fire took hold on board, investigators will assess whether it was the cause of an electrical fault or whether human intervention was involved, such as a device on the aircraft. Smoke indications could also be triggered by other factors, for example, condensation in the event of a sudden decompression. The final 2 messages refer to faults with the flight control computers. They were sent 4 minutes before contact was lost with the aircraft's transponder, which relays details of the aircraft and its location. Now, these reports are short text messages sent to the airline engineering base and the aircraft manufacturer. They're intended to inform ground staff about the status of the aircraft. they're not designed to relay alarms to the ground. Now, this is an important development, as you mentioned.
Yes.
Do you think that there will be further evidence, because now there's two possible scenarios because of the smoke messages that were sent, if there was a human intervention to create this catastrophe, or if there was a mechanical fault? Do you think that it could be verified if a fire was started, that it was the cause of the crash? Do you think that they can, forensics can identify such a possibility?
At any way, we have a smoke, we have explosive. This, if there are explosive on board, or if we have technical or mechanical or electronic fault in the system. But if you review, we speak about the autopilot in this time, because the autopilot that sent this messages, then there is no control for the pilot. This make the possibility of committing suicide is must be eliminated, because if the pilot wanna commit suicide, not dependence on the autopilot.
Indeed.
Also, the way the jetliner dropped reflect that there is no control
whatsoever
of the pilot or autopilot. The turned left
suddenly and
left
spun.
Side 90 and full circle to the right. This
indicates something.
Indicate that in this time the airliner is disintegrated in the air. The first step around 37,000 feet altitude in the beginning disintegrated. In this time, no control due to something wrong that caused explosion. This explosion due to terror attack or from the system itself because of malfunction of the system. After this, the appear again in 15,000 feet and disappear in 9,000 altitude. 9,000 feet altitude. In this time, the body is crashed down for a small pieces that's
which
dropped
in the
sea.
Ocean, no, in the sea.
Okay, but the final decision must come after the two black box when someone find them. But I think it's the good thing is that the black box work till 6 kilometers depth in the sea. This region from 1.5 kilometer to 2.7 kilometer, which is in the range of working of the black
box.
So
there's a high possibility that the black
boxes
will be
found. Also, the black box work for 4 weeks or for 5 weeks
after the crash.
After this, the battery not contain the charge that make
sufficient
charge.
Another similar article from the New York Times. A headline reads: data points to rapid loss of control aboard Egypt Air jet. It says a piece of luggage adrift in the Mediterranean Sea, floating nearby a passenger seat from the plane. Scraps of metal, scattered personal belongings, and finally, the grim discovery of human remains. As the investigations continue into what caused an Egypt Air flight from Paris to Cairo to suddenly and violently plunge from the sky, the discovery of the debris allowed search crews to home in on the location of the crash, an area about 180 miles north of Alexandria, even as its cause remained a mystery and the subject of intense speculation. Data that was transmitted from the aircraft to operators on the ground, published Friday by a respected aviation journal, revealed the rapid loss of control with alarms and computer system failures in the seconds before the plane was lost from radar. No bulk wreckage has yet been found. The parts of the aircraft are most likely to provide clues, including the voice and data records, are also the most likely to quickly sink in the sea floor. An Egyptian official said investigators consider terrorism to be a possible cause, but no terrorist group has yet claimed responsibility. Officials cautioned there was no direct evidence to suggest a bomb aboard the plane or any other deliberate act of sabotage. Now, France's domestic intelligence chief warned just a few days ago that France was at risk of coming under a new form of attack from Daesh, and that the country was clearly its top target. Do you see any possibility that there could be a link drawn between these statements by the domestic intelligence chief?
Yes. Mm. Also, we read about that some investigation conduct now in the airport about people may be in connection or direct or indirect connection with ISIS or Salafist group. I think, the dilemma now that no terror group claimed responsibility about the accident. This if a terror,
yet they
every
often,
time,
even if they didn't do it, they claim responsibility.
Claim this time, not claim. This reflects that intentionally put their side in the opposite side of Egypt responsibility. If responsibility to be terror attacks, then in the first minutes, ISIS or Ansar Beit al-Maqdis or any other group claim the responsibility about the accident. But I expect someone to claim its responsibility. But even ISIS claimed its responsibility about the accident, then France will ask them, what's your evidence about that you commit this accident? Contrarily, if they claim about Egypt's responsibility in Sharm el-Sheikh, if someone in a small website claimed responsibility, they accepted this and try to publish this. Also, this kind of accident may need from 2 or 3 years in investigation, even if they find the two black box. During this time, we will be convicted of this crime, even if we are guilty or
unguilty. Dr. Samir, that also leads me to another question. The repercussions, indeed, this is a tragic incident.
Yes.
And terrible tragedy and loss for the families of these victims. But the repercussions are grave, not only for Egypt Air, not only for Egypt, not only for tourism, for the whole concept of getting aviation back on track, getting
yes.
the Egyptian economy.
Aviation industry.
Indeed.
Yes.
So let's talk a bit about the repercussions of this tragic incident for the Egyptian tourism, which is already seems to be under attack from several
yes.
other factors. Let's talk a bit about the repercussions and what needs to be done, in your opinion, to start to rebuild the image of Egypt Air, of Egyptian tourism, of Egypt as a safe destination ultimately at the end of the day.
Yes, first of all, our responsibility as an Egyptian to support our national company must use the airliner of the airline of Egypt Air. I see some campaign on social media, on Twitter, on Facebook, that we will use
Egypt Air.
We will not use another airline. It's good for domestic. For the world must stick with our official opinion about this accident. I am against analysts or commentators that make this catastrophe situation to make to be famous about it in analysis that they adopt the American opinion or the European opinions. Also, which is the responsibility on the media? We must reach for the high reachability media. We must treat the matter practically. We must, may we hire hours in a famous media or TV channels like CNN, like Euronews, like BBC, that when we treat this matter practically. We have Nile TV is with a very good reputation, with a high professionality of team in front of the camera and the backward of the camera, but technically hasn't the reachability
to reach these target audiences.
To reach America, to reach South Africa, to reach Asia. So we must treat this matter and this a kind of investment. To make advertisement about Egypt, to make advertisement about Egypt itself, indeed, about the security, to be involved in the famous talk show in CNN, to our ambassadors and our embassy in the world must make a conference, make a workshop for the
further publicity.
For the publicity indeed, in any industry related to aviation or...
Right, let's go to another news item from The Guardian. Headline reads, body part and seats from Egypt Air flight found. This is according to Greece. Greek defense minister says debris, also including suitcases, were found. However, the cause of the crash still not clear. Debris from the missing Egypt airplane, including a body part, two seats and suitcases, were found by vessels in the Mediterranean Sea. Earlier, the Egyptian military said it had found personal belongings and parts of the wreckage, and Greek authorities said they also received information that the wreckage was discovered, and Egypt has been leading the search effort with support from France, Greece, Turkey, the UK. The US Navy also dispatched a P-3 Orion maritime surveillance aircraft from a base in Sicily. How do you, Dr. Samir, view the Egyptian military and the Egyptian officials dealing with this incident? Their response?
Yes, very professional, highly professional. Yeah. I comment on this directly. The first authority that make actions, the naval vessel depart after minutes from the information of the accident. The crisis management department of the armed forces begin to take the required measure in this kind of accident. All their comments and declaration is highly professional. Also, coordination with Italy, with France, with all naval forces in Eastern Mediterranean. You used to this. It's every time armed forces prove that it's the highly disciplinary department and highly patriotic people. So we must focus about the effort to find the wreckage. This wreckage separated in about 45 miles square in the sea. If we have this area and in the land, it's very difficult. In Sharm el Sheikh jetliner, it take months of in searching in the land. What about the sea? And we speak about deep sea around 2 kilometers depth. Mm-hmm. Also, in this region in the Mediterranean, not a smooth bottom. The bottom in this area, especially, it's crumbled, not a smooth.
Another challenge in finding.
Yes, another
the
challenge. The first challenge, to receive the transmitted signal from the two boxes. Mm. Till now,
nothing has been received.
After this, the location of this, to indicate the location of the two boxes. After this, how to use a robot
to get them. And then to decipher what
yes,
the messages
are. And to find them in a good condition that can extract a data about voice record or about flight
or
data and information, flight speed, and last minutes in the life of this airliner and crew and passenger. Mm-hmm. This a very big challenge
indeed.
That the armed forces put it in their shoulder.
Indeed. The Telegraph reports another headline, the Egypt air crash could signal a disturbing new twist on the war on terror. Following the disappearance of Egypt Air Flight MS-804, Egypt's civil aviation minister suggested that terrorism is a stronger possibility than mechanical failure. Russia's domestic intelligence chief has agreed, calling it a monstrous attack. According to the American news networks, U.S. officials have said there's strong indications, probably from satellites, of an explosion in the area where the plane disappeared. We can only hope that they are mistaken, because if it was indeed brought down deliberately, it would have a significant consequences, not just for Egypt, but for global aviation. What backlash do you see on global aviation? Do you see airports in several countries upping their security systems, running checks? France itself said it not only upped its security measures, but it runs checks on security personnel. If anyone that has a role to play next to the aircraft or by the aircraft or inside
yes.
the aircraft has any relation to any questionable people or members of any questionable community or society or organization, do you think that these measures are sufficient, or do you think that more needs to be done to ensure that if indeed this was another terrorist attack, it could have been avoided?
Yes, the dilemma of the aviation industry that it's a global network, not dependent on your own measures, security measure, or your security procedures, because may you have a very good and optimum measures, but the airliner and the jetliner come to you from another airport, like this case, this accident. So must has a coordination in all over the world, not in aviation industry, but in fighting terrorism. There is no shared data in terrorists around the world. Someone may be a famous terrorist in Syria, but in Egypt is innocent man. If he can come here from any airport, no data record for them to reflect what is the
so more
record.
Intelligence sharing, more information sharing is crucial
yes.
between
yes.
countries.
Yes.
But there always seems to be a hesitance by countries
yes.
to share their intelligence.
Or
share
case by case, not in
general.
A framework that to share knowledge and share data, even with Arab countries. There is no database sharing. Now the world exceeds the stage of database. Now the world speaks about knowledge base, to share knowledge, not just data. Because in this situation, you must data the ridiculous and the catastrophic thing that a day after the accident, the aviation authority hasn't the data of the passenger. With the data for passenger from Paris, the day after the accident, presumably to have the passenger list before the aeroplane depart from the departure airport. It's a catastrophe. How a country like Egypt does not know
even the people that are coming in.
And depends on that they has a visa or some countries
don't need even
visa. Then we have backdoors that may be excluded by the terror group, state or non-state actors. Non-state actors target this industry, the aviation, airport, passenger, airliner, because he work around the media. When you make this kind of accident, we take a media, all the world, news
to this issue.
To this issue, and I think this will last maybe months.
Indeed.
And before we finish an accident, we have a new accident in Egypt, in France, in Brussels. This must need to devote more effort.
Indeed.
In this sector, because I find myself in some countries. Vulnerable area that make anyone excluded may reach to even the gate of trouble.
Let's go to the New York Times. Another incident, another headline. Greece releases timeline of Egypt Air MS-804 final moments. Greece's Civil Aviation Department released a statement with a timeline on Egypt Air's MS-804's latest and last moments and Greek attempts to contact it. The timeline released goes as follows. At 02:24 a.m., Egypt Air flight from Paris to Cairo enters Greek airspace. Air traffic controller permissions it for the remainder of its course. At 02:48, the flight is transferred to the next air traffic control sector and is cleared for exit from Greek airspace. The pilot was in good spirits and thanked the controller in Greek, using Greek language.
Yes.
03:27, Athens Air Traffic Control tries to contact the aircraft to convey information on the switch of communications and control from Athens to Cairo air traffic. In spite of the repeated calls, the aircraft does not respond, whereupon the air traffic controller calls the distress frequency without a response from the aircraft. At 03:29, it is above the exit point from Greek airspace, and then at 03:39, the aircraft signal is lost approximately 7 nautical miles south-southeast of the Akumbi point, where Cairo for immediately the assistance of radars of the Hellenic Air Force is requested to detect the target without result. At 03:45, the process of search and rescues are initiated, simultaneously informing the flight information region of Cairo. Now, Greece has given quite a detailed log of the flight during its entrance from its airspace to its exit. Quite a lot of gaps, distance time-wise, before the flight was totally lost from the radar. Do you think that this could indicate that there was some sort of turbulence, disturbance? Why do you think such a gap existed?
The aviation authority in Greece keep control and the communication with the jetliner.
Okay.
Not continuous communication. This frequently, occasionally. In this point, this a regular action that inform the captain that he depart from Greece and now he must
enter in Cairo.
He must
contact radar,
contact,
the Egyptian
approach
side
of Cairo Air Tower.
Okay.
This not during all the flight, because
contact.
Because the aviation observer and the controller control
several
several airliner in the same time.
Indeed.
But I think they try to call them in 2 o'clock past 30, I think.
At 2:48, the flight was transferred to the next air traffic. The pilot was in good spirits. Then at 03:29, it is above the exit point. At 03:39, the signal is lost. So 10 minutes.
39, okay. This, after they tried to call them several times. Airbus indicates the time with 30, not 40.
So there's a 9 minute gap.
This 9 minutes that disappeared from
the radar.
From the radar and keep sure that there is something wrong, make it disappear and disappear for the last time. Because no communication
was received.
System that to disappear and they come back again. I think when we connect this with the automated messages that send that there are a fire in the navigator bay and the right window in the cabinet is opened, this during this time they received automated messages that cast shadows about something wrong. Then try to call the pilot again.
To no avail.
There is no, and there is no carrier. The carrier is a wave that indicates that we have a communication, but we haven't a voice. In this time, no communication and no carrier for the signal. Then,
which means no flight.
No flight, yes.
Let's go to The Guardian. Another headline reads, France sending investigators, technical experts to help Egypt Air probe. France is sending three investigators to Cairo along with a technical expert team from Airbus to join the probe into Egypt Air flight that crashed Thursday. This was a statement by the transport minister, Alain Vidals. The team, including agents from France's Special Bureau of Investigations and Analysis, were sent to leave later in the day to help probe with what happened in the plane carrying 66 people from Paris to Cairo. A positive collaboration, do you think it could bring about quicker results? Because at the end of the day...
The collaboration is not an option. It's have to. It's must. Because we have the Egyptian prosecutor general and also the attorney or prosecutor general of France, because we have the evidence between the airport and the sea and the passenger. The passenger from several countries include the majority from Egypt and 15 from France and from Saudi Arabia and from Iraq and from Chad and from Canada. Then all this must subject to investigation. Also, but in this, in our case of Sharm el Sheikh, then the Egyptian authority responsible for all the investigation team. I think if we treat the matter with the same, must the prosecutor general of France must lead the investigation, and then Egypt has a right to follow up the investigation and to keep sure that everything run subject to the international law of aviation, which is Montreal Warsaw Treaty 1929 and the Montreal Treaty 1971.
Well, indeed, we must admit that Egypt has taken a very high stance and the high road in dealing with all the possible parties to the investigations and to the causes, the possible causes, the possible wrongdoers in this tragedy. And of course, we will be bringing you more updates throughout the days to come on any of the developments regarding this tragic flight. I'm afraid we have run out of time, Dr. Samir Raghib, our political analyst and our guest for this afternoon. I'd like to thank you very much, sir, for joining us. And ladies and gentlemen, with that, we wrap up today's special edition of The World Today. My name is Angie Meher. Many thanks for joining us.